Praise you, Lord Jesus.
Glory to his name. Thank you, Lord. Won't you stand with us? Good to see everybody here. Glory to God. Hallelujah.
Praise you, Lord.
Glory to his name.
Bless your name.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Come on. I'm trading my sorrow.
I'm trading my sorrow.
I'm trading
my shame.
But not crushed, persecuted, not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. Well, I'm blessed beyond the curse, for his promise will endure, that his joy's gonna be my strength. Though the sorrow may last for the night, his joy comes with the morning.
I'm trading my sorrow, I'm trading my shame.
But not crushed, persecuted, not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. Well, I'm blessed beyond the curse, for his promise will endure, that his joy's got to be my strength. Though the sorrow may last for the night, or his joy comes
in the morning. I'm trading my sorrow.
Joy of the Lord.
I'm trading my sorrow.
but not crushed, persecuted, not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. Well, I'm blessed beyond the curse, for his promise will endure. That his joy's got to be my strength. Though the sorrow may last for the night, his joy comes with the morning.
I'm trading my sorrow.
Pressed but not crushed, persecuted, not abandoned.
Woo!
Struck down but not destroyed. Oh, I'm blessed beyond the curse, for his promise will endure. That his joy is gonna be my strength. Though the sorrow may last for the night, his joy comes with the morning.
I'm trading my sorrow. I'm trading my pain.
Let it go.
I'm laying down
the joy of the Lord.
Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Amen. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's do this right here. Let's do this. Come on, say.
His reality. God's reality. No more spirit of error shall abide in me.
His reality, say.
His reality.
Hallelujah, say. No more spirit of error shall abide. His reality, say.
His reality.
Yeah, yeah, say.
God's reality.
No more spirit of error shall abide. His reality, say.
His reality. Woo!
God's reality. No more spirit of error. Shout out.
against the knowledge of shutting the door. I'm shutting the door. Against the knowledge, his reality to his reality.
Come on, say it.
God's reality, no more spirit of error
shall abide in me.
His reality to
his reality.
God's reality, no more spirit of error shall abide. His reality, say, his reality. God's reality, no more spirit of error shall abide in. His reality, say, his reality. God's reality, no more spirit of error shall
abide. Come on, y'all.
Shut the door.
I'm shutting the door. Shut the door.
Shut the door.
Shut the door.
Come on, say it.
Shut the door on the enemy. I'm pulling down stronghold
in every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge. His reality, say,
his reality.
God's reality. No more spirit of error
shall abide in.
His reality, say,
his reality.
God's reality. No more spirit of error shall abide.
Shut the door.
I'm shutting the door.
Shut the door.
Shut the door. Against the knowledge of, I'm pulling down stronghold in every high thing that exalts itself. Against the knowledge of, I'm pulling down stronghold in every high thing that exalts itself. Against the knowledge. And every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm shutting the door. I'm shutting the door. I'm shutting the door. Shut the door on the enemy. I'm shutting the door.
Come on, say it out your mouth. Declare it.
Shut the door. Shut the door.
shut the door. Shut the door. Shut the door. Shut the door.
I'm pulling down.
I'm pulling down strongholds in every high thing that exalts itself against the night.
I'm pulling down.
I'm pulling down strongholds in every high thing that exalts itself against the night.
I'm pulling down.
I'm pulling down.
I'm pulling down.
Down.
I'm pulling 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 down.
In every high thing.
In every high thing. That exalts itself against the night. God.
Come on.
Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
He loves us.
Yes.
Oh, how he loves us.
Hallelujah. Says.
Oh, how
sing it, Pastor.
He loves us.
Yes.
Oh, how.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Think about his love.
Think about his goodness. Think about his grace that brought us through. For as high as the heavens above, so great is
is the measure of our Father's love. Great is the measure of our Father's love. So great, so great is the measure of our Father's love.
Come on. Thank you for your love, yeah. Thank you for your love, yeah, yeah. Thank you for your goodness. Hallelujah, we say. Thank you for your grace that brought us through. For as high as the heavens above, so great is the measure of our Father's love. Great is the measure of our Father's love. So great, so great is the measure of our Father's love.
Come on, y'all.
We receive your love. Receive your love, yeah, yeah. Oh, we receive your goodness. Hallelujah, we say. We receive your grace that's brought us through. For as high as the heavens above, yeah, yeah. So great is the measure of our Father's love.
So great is the measure of our Father's love.
Come on, y'all, come on. We will share your love. Who say?
We will share your love.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, we will share your goodness.
Hallelujah, we say.
We will share your grace. That brought us through.
So great is the measure
of our Father's love. Great is the measure of our Father's love.
So great.
So great is the measure of our Father's love.
So great.
So great. Of our Father's love.
So great,
so great is the measure of our Father's love.
So great,
so great is the measure of our Father's love.
So great,
so great is the measure of our Father's love.
So great,
so great is the measure of our Father's love.
So great
is the measure of our Father's love.
Hallelujah.
Come on, come on.
Glory,
come on, come on, come on, come on. Hallelujah, come on. Hallelujah, yeah. Hallelujah, yeah. Glory, yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. For as high as the heavens above, so great is the measure of our Father's love.
measure of our Father's love. So great, so great is the measure of our Father's love.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank
So great is the measure of our Father's love. So great as far from east to west. So great that his blood was shed on Calvary for you and me and y'all too who are watching. Thank you all for joining us today. Happy, happy Sunday, everyone. Welcome online. Thank you for tuning in. Tell us where you're watching from. And I'd also like to say, oh, y'all do look good this morning. Y'all do. Y'all look real good. And if you are with us for the first time, welcome, welcome, welcome. It is so good to see you. Give us a wave. If you are here for us for the first time. And we also have a treat for you. We have the message that, of course, is always wonderful. And we have a bag of goodies for you. We ask that you fill out the card in the front seat pocket of your chair because we want to stay connected with you. So if you would fill that out, the best way to contact you so we can stay in touch. Also, there's this thing we do on Sunday nights, and it's called prayer. And it's from 6:30 to 7 o'clock. Not long, just a little bit of time where we work on building an army, not an audience, because that's what we are here to do. No spectators. We're here to work. That kingdom work, y'all. And part of that kingdom work is prayer. So, I mean, come on out. And let's get prayed up. We also are building our army by giving our five. Do you have your five? Your five. Those five that you are praying for, believing God for. Those five that you're touching hearts. It could be on your job, in the supermarket. You develop in a relationship, and then, you know, will them in. Bring them. We love people, we love Jesus, and we are a safe place. And we also have the Bible app. So if you have not downloaded that, that is another way to stay in the know. All things RLC. You can also fill out that card that's in a front seat pocket as well if you are not in the know. But the Bible app is a great way. Yeah, that thing too. I love you, Miss Fowler. But the Bible app is also a great way to, what does it do, y'all? Y'all don't know. What does the Bible app do? It's something that you can follow along with the message as it is being preached. It is something that you can go back to study with as you listen to the word again. If it's something like, oh man, what did he say? He said something about faith. I lost it. Go to the Bible app. It's in there. What he said is in there, and it's a great tool to reference. So if you do not have that downloaded, get that downloaded. Ladies? Yes. Hi, ladies. We are having our meeting. When is that meeting again? Y'all know? Exactly. It's May 14th, Friday at 6:45. We are meeting. We're going to celebrate mothers. So bring a picture of your mother and something. What are we bringing to share? Food. Yes, we're bringing food, a dish, your famous dish, meatballs, spaghetti, cheesecake. Bring it. We're going to have a great time as we are edified spiritually and fed physically. With that said, make sure you get your free CD after service. And also, Pastor, happy birthday. Yeah. Happiest of birthdays to you, sir. I will say, I do have the mic. Yes, we do. We love you and we celebrate you, even though we know you're not like all fanfare-ish, but legit, we are very honored to have you as the spiritual father of this house. For real. And everything that your heart desires, of course, is yours. Because you know more than anybody, I think you know what I'm going to say. If it is written, then our uncertainty is unnecessary. So you know that more than anybody. So it's already done. And just thank you for leading this house. And as you've led this house, it has completely blessed me because I'm part of this house. So keep doing what you're doing. Going hard in the paint. Happy birthday.
I like abnormal, weird people. Thank you for the birthday. All right, Princess, it's all yours.
Oh, okay. Pastor Jimmy wanted me to, I'm not, I'm going to do good today, aren't I? He's going to help me. Okay, so I don't do this very often. I will tell the story first. I asked Pastor Jimmy, what do you want for your birthday? He said, all I want is for Real Life Church to have our own property. That's all I want. And I thought about how long I've known him. We've been, this August will be 32 years we've been married. Actually, let's say when we met 32 years ago, I know him. And all he ever wanted to be was a pastor. That's all he ever wanted to be. And then the Lord shifted us to be missionaries so that he could train us with some extra spiritual muscles. And with that coming here, we were equipped spiritually in many ways. But my husband always wanted to be a pastor, and he that was his thing. And so we've been here in this we started the church, pioneered this summer. 13 years. So I think it's time for a building, don't you? I thought about, well, I told you, some of you weren't here last week to hear our little story. Is it okay if I tell that? Okay. So Pastor Jimmy has an office over here, and I said, love, I just keep seeing that we're supposed to be packing, I'm supposed to pack your office up. And he's like, no, it's not time, no. And usually I see stuff ahead of time. And sometimes the Lord would give me 6 months' notice, but this time it was like a couple months. And I just waited for it to simmer and see when would this, okay, engage. Star Trek, isn't that what he said? Engage, right? So I asked, can I go ahead and pack the your office? Engage. It's like, yes. So packing all the delicate things, don't touch my desk. And then he said, you can go ahead and pack my desk, but the holy grail of what you never touch are his books. Never. Not me. I do not write in his books. There's a law in our home. And I could tell you many funny stories, but I won't do it. So I learned watching him over the years, we've moved a lot. And over the years, he always is like the very first thing that goes are the books. The last thing that goes are the books. And then when we move to the next place, the books are the first things that come up. Not the dishes, the books. And so I said, I'm not going to touch these books. And I'm just going to see when he's going to do it and it's going to be the right time. So that night, I got it all packed. The pictures are packed. Blah, 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 the curtains are down. And he said, you can go ahead and pack the books. And I was like, what? Because I had just said in the office by myself, you know how you talk to yourself? I'm just going to wait. And he said, you can go ahead and pack the books. And that was a sign to me. So some of you already heard that, but I wanted some of you that didn't hear that. That's a very big deal. So anyhow, I asked Pastor Jimmy, what do you want for your birthday? And he said, I want our church property. And we've been wanting to tap, you know, put the roots down. We've had a home here, and we own our home. And this is our home. And you will never see us leave because we know this is where we're supposed to be the rest of our life. And so I said, well, the Lord's going to have to give you your present, but I'm going to believe that he's going to give you your present. So are y'all going to believe? Yeah. So we ask the Lord right now in Jesus' name for the Real Life Church property, for our permanent home. Are you in agreement with us? And Lord, I ask for it now in Jesus' name, right now, because our lease will be ending, and this will be, you know, we have to have it. So some things are cooking, and things are marinating, and we can't talk about it. But I just want you to know God's working. So we're praising the Lord, and we're skipping down the glory lane and seeing him do things, little things here and there. But you know what? So we thought, I said, okay, so you want your building. I don't know how to do this. So we moved the church. This will be our fifth time that we've moved the church. This will be the fifth time. And we are really good at it. And I'm not going to complain, but we are super blessed with a lot of stuff, and we always have been. I mean, always. So it takes a lot to move. It costs money. And when we moved here, there was a big-time supernatural thing God did. We had sown all of our money into a ministry, and we needed a place to go, and there was nowhere to go. And we basically emptied the church bank account. And ours, because we needed a miracle. And then that week, boom, this place came open. And then in a few months, we were here. But then we had emptied the account. And so God, I think an angel brought a big, huge offering, because when he counted the offering, because we only had, 12 people? Less than 20 people. So we didn't have a whole lot of money. And we had to build the stage. I said, love, we have to have carpet. Can I tell them the carpet story? Okay, I said, we need to have carpet because the anointing's going to fall and people are going to fall over this place, and there needs to be a padded carpet. And he said, we can't do it. love, we got to have carpet. And he's like, I have spent everything. We have no money. I said, but love, there's got to be carpet from one end to the other because people are going to be falling out everywhere. You know, the power of the Holy Spirit. That's what we want, right? Sure enough, the first service, three women came up crying, I've seen you on TV. Will you please pray for me? And then thankfully, our usher had come in and rushed to grab them, but they fell on the no rug. You know, the Lord, they didn't get hurt, but I said, see, I told you. But they had to build the stage, and it took a lot, you know. I'm just telling you, it takes a lot. So, but I didn't know the dollar signs, like, you know what I mean? He knows more about the finances I do. I'm in the faith world. God is like the pie in the sky, whatever, and it's going to come. And that's the way I see it. So he kind of doesn't give me that burden. And so I'm able to really dream and then see God do it. So he's like the anchor, and I'm like the one that, you know, we kind of work good together. So what happened is this huge offering came in, but still it was gone. And so then all of a sudden one day he said, okay, it's time to go look for the carpet. And I was like, yes, I'm so glad. And we went to this one carpet place, and that was where we got all of our good deals. And he was like, we're going to just get that garage carpet that's black and it's cheap, and it's the kind you would put in the garage, and we'll put them on the stage. And I was like, no, you're not doing it. We're on TV already. We are not doing it. But he just couldn't, you know what I mean? The money's going out everywhere. And it's not his fault at all. It was just, you know what I'm saying? Y'all are human, right? And I was like, nope, you're not doing it. And I was like, Lord, you have got to bring this beautiful carpet. And so finally this carpet came for the stage, and it was a windinger of a deal, commercial carpet. Really good deal. We already had the curtains. That's another cool story, but I won't tell on that one. So then he said, let's go get this one here, 60 feet. And the week before, we had gone to Tulsa, to ORU. And I was so discouraged because it's like, we're not getting the carpet. We're not getting the carpet. I said, we're not getting the carpet. We don't have the money for it. But I stood it and looked at Oral Roberts University, and I said, God, you paved that whole parking lot. There's thousands of parking spots. And you carpeted Oral Roberts' yard with pavement. So surely you can give me 6 feet of carpet across the room. It helped me. You know what I mean? So we went up there, and we didn't see the right color to match this. And so he was going to make this deal on, you know, they're already in the office typing up the order, and I'm really upset. Lord, you got to do it. Where is it? Where is it? And I was looking everywhere. Went down the main aisle. You don't think to go down the main aisle because that's going to be the most expensive, right? Right from the door. And I was like, what is that huge roll? And then flipped it over, and it was this carpet, and it was 27 cents a square foot. So someone who actually sells carpet, they said this is actually a $5,000 piece of carpet. And we got it for, it was under $350, well, with the padding, under $350. And so I call this carpet the miracle carpet. And see, not only is it miracle because of God's provision, but it's miracle because miracles happen on this carpet. And it really does happen. So there's anointing on this carpet. All right? So I'm sorry about it. Okay. So I'm supposed to take the offering up because what most people like to give Pastor Jimmy a gift, or, you know, they give him money and they bless him. But we want to make it possible for him to have his church property. And not him, the real life church family, to have our church property. You understand, but I want to make sure I say it right because y'all are family. This is our home. Real Life Church is our home. And we have to have a really good facility, right? We got so many pregnant women, we're going to need more room for the babies. Y'all can hook up with that, mamas, right? So if you want to give him a birthday gift, do it towards the building or towards the move. Just do it like that, okay? So we just want to mention that. Okay, now, with the giving, I'm excited I get to give. I don't usually get to throw my envelope in the bucket. I love to give because every time I do, I know there's all these provision, these promises God has. He says, first of all, I rebuke the devourer for your sakes. You know, the enemy's trying to gobble up your stuff. Your car breaks down. Your refrigerator breaks down. Somebody gets sick. You need to buy some whatever. And God makes your cars last longer. He makes your refrigerators last longer. He makes everything last longer if you believe for it. Now, you got to believe for it. You don't just do it by osmosis. But he said, I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes, right? Bring all your tithes into the storehouse. I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes. I mean, that's a really good promise right there. I love that one. And then, but also there's multiplication of our things. I mean, I've seen stuff last a really, really long time, and I know it's because he blessed it. So even our car has tons of miles, but he blesses it. I feel the Holy Ghost. All right, so if you have your offering, I'm not used to doing the offering, y'all. If you have your offering or your text in your phone, we're going to raise it up. And, Lord, we ask you to bless it, Father. We thank you, Lord, that we have this opportunity to give. We thank you, Father, that you provide for us all of our needs according to your riches and glory, Lord. We thank you, Father, for multiplication, Lord, of resources. We thank you, Father, for divine health, Lord. We praise you, Father. Hallelujah, that the Holy Ghost lives in our home, Lord. We thank you, Father, that we get to give to you, Lord, and we know that you're taking care of us, Father. We give these offerings to you, Lord, just like people give in offerings when they gave their stuff in Europe, in the Eastern countries. They would give their flowers. They would go and pick flowers and give their flowers, or they would give their chickens, or they would give their produce from their garden, see? And this is your time. This money here that you're giving is your time, which is so valuable. You can't take it back, right? We can't take back our time. But we give God our time because with our job, right? Hallelujah. So that means he'll multiply our time too. Amen? He'll make it more productive. Our job's more productive. That's what I'm declaring right now. Our job's more productive. Our business is more productive. Our children more productive. Hallelujah. Bless our children, Lord, in school, Father. We thank you, Lord. The mentality of us all, Father, is blessed because we've tapped into the kingdom of heaven. Hallelujah. We've tapped into God's resources, which is abundance in every way, right? Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Y'all can go ahead and bring your offering up. Hallelujah. Is it bad? Did I be bad? And happy birthday, love.
Thank you, princess. I love you. You can take that with you. Hey, Cleve, can you come help her? Hallelujah. We do not play that song every week, so don't get offended. Hallelujah. All right. Well, I'll wait a few more seconds. Is it good with you?
Yes, sir.
God been good to you?
Yes.
Hallelujah, Father. All right, let me get my, so you get out of here on time. Bill Withers will tell us when it's time to end. 38 minutes and 30 seconds from now. All right, today we're going to continue on the path that we stepped out into last week, and we're going to talking about freedom. And I want you to go to Galatians chapter 5, verse 1, and I don't want to say everything that I said last week. If you didn't get the chance to hear last week's message, please go to our YouTube channel or our Facebook page. It's up in a bunch of places, but it'd really be good for you to listen to it because a great many of us have been conditioned by the teaching that we've received in the church and even in our culture to accept less than complete freedom. We've been conditioned to accept morsels of freedom and think that it's okay. But what I want you to see is that God created you for freedom. He created you to take dominion. Let me word it to you this way. He created you for dominion, and he ordained you to reign. Mankind was never created to be dominated by anything or anyone. Even in the very beginning, God himself did not dominate man. Selah. I'm going to let that sink in for a second. Because I want you to consider this. If God himself does not dominate man, then why would we, as children of God, allow ourselves to be dominated by anyone or anything? Because we weren't created to be dominated. Not by preachers, not by priests, and not by politicians. We were created in the image of God to walk in the life of God. The Bible says this, and this is all, that even as he is, so are we now in this world. Is Jesus Christ addicted? Is he impoverished? Is he in pain? Is he dominated by anything? The answer is no. So if he is not those things, we are not meant to be those things. Now, I will tell you this, and I think I said this last week. Once you know what God has ordained for you, the fight is on. And if you're not willing to fight for it, it will be taken from you. And that's what we find in the book of Galatians. The church of Galatia had received, had heard the voice of Paul as he preached a message of grace. And that message of grace brought great freedom into their lives. But Paul was always aware that everywhere he went, there were people who came behind him. And he said that they came to spy out the liberty. They wanted to take a look at how free Paul had made people. Because can I tell you something? People who want to control you are afraid of your freedom. There are people in your life who don't want you free because they profit off of using you for their ends. They just do. This is the reason why you got to fight for it. So these people that would come behind Paul to spy out the liberty of the church, they would begin to preach another gospel, which Paul said really is not a gospel at all, right? But the church at Galatia had listened to these people as they had come in and bewitched the church of Galatia by mixing a little bit of legalism with a little bit of grace. In other words, they'd say, well, you know, it's okay to be free here, but you got to be careful here. And I shared with you last week, I can't tell you how many preachers over the years have told me things like, yeah, it's good, Cleve, to tell people God loves them, but. It's good to let people know they're free, but not too free. Because after all, if you know they're too free, they're going to sin. But over time, you know what I've discovered? If somebody wants to sin, it don't much matter what you preach. They're going to sin. And they don't need your permission. They're going to do it anyhow, right? So it's not the message of freedom and grace that releases a sinful nature. That's already there. But grace sets people free. And this is what Paul came to when he heard about the Galatians, that they had surrendered their liberty for a sense of security and ended up with tyranny, because that's always what happens. Paul said, "You foolish Galatians." And then he asked them a question. He said, who has cast a spell on you? Who's bewitched you to get you to believe that it's better to live enslaved than it is to live free? And this is what he said in Galatians chapter 5, and this is part 2 of last week's message. Galatians chapter 5, verse 1, it was for freedom. Everyone say freedom. Now, I said to you last week, I got to say it again. We got to be aware of what the Bible says and what the Bible doesn't say. Right? Paul did not come to the Galatians and say it was for heaven that Christ set you free. Now, Pastor, what are you saying here? Now, you be careful. Heaven is a grand and glorious part of our future. But you ain't there yet. So if heaven is all that the salvation message is about, then it's got nothing to do with this life. Because after all, it's only about heaven. Now, if it's only about heaven, and that's the preaching most of us have heard, if it's only about heaven, then we can be convinced that we ought to endure or even embrace things we ought to resist. Because after all, you don't got to be blessed to get to heaven. And if it's only about heaven, you don't actually need to be blessed. In fact, you ought to embrace poverty, because through poverty, you prove the sincerity of your love. And you ought to resist poverty, But if it's only about heaven, you don't got to be rich to go. In fact, they'll often quote, you know, it's easier for a poor man. A rich man finds it hard. Wow. Come on now. Y'all listen, we got to kick over some sacred cows if we're going to eat some hamburger. And I have worked too hard to get to the top of the food chain to be a vegan now. If God's got it for me, I want it. And but, you know, so down the line, if it's only about heaven, then you don't got to be happy. If it's only about heaven, you don't got to be joyful. In fact, the greater your cross, the greater your devotion. And so we embrace things he set us free from. So Paul comes along and he's not diminishing heaven by any means. But he says it was for freedom that Christ set you free. And then he says this, he says, therefore, now Brother Hagin used to always tell us, when you see the word therefore, see what it's there for. He said, stand firm or keep standing firm.
Yeah.
Why? Because even after Christ sets you free, if you're not willing to fight for the privileges of the kingdom, somebody will take them from you. If you lay down and let them, they'll walk all over you. And they'll strip every right Christ died that you would have. And they'll make you feel good about them stripping your rights from you. So Paul says, keep standing firm and do not, everyone say do not. Do not be subject again to a yoke of slavery. Do not accept slavery. You know, Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11, God said, I know the plan that I have for you. And I'm paraphrasing. He said, it's a good plan where you fare well. It's not a bad plan. God did not plan for you to be dominated, diminished, or enslaved. God has a plan for your life, and God's plan requires you to be completely free. Completely free. Free from everything that diminishes the quality and the quantity of your life. Y'all follow me? Because I said this to you last week, and I'm going to say it again, and I'll probably say it ad nauseum in the years to come. Anything that dominates you diminishes you. Anything. It doesn't matter what it is. Sometimes we think, well, you know, there's big sins and little sins. And I knew a guy one time, I counseled with him. And he was dominated. He was a minister. And he was dominated by pornography. Couldn't stop looking at it. And we would all say, oh, well, that's bad. I also knew another preacher that was dominated by Dr. Pepper. Well, Pastor, you need to explain that. Gladly. I wouldn't have brought it up if I wasn't going to explain it. The Lord had been telling this man for 2 years to stop drinking Dr. Pepper because he drank about a half gallon of it a day. Isn't that right? 2 liters? Before? More than that? The dude, and the Lord kept telling him, stop it, stop it, stop it, stop it. Anything that dominates you, if you can't stop it, it's got you. You ain't got it. And after 2 years, he started having some pains. So he went to the doctor, and they did what they did, and they discovered the dude had like Superman-sized kidney stones. And they tried chemicals. Chemicals didn't touch it. They tried those ultrasounds or whatever it is to break it up. Didn't touch it. And the doctor finally said, these things are like invincible. You got no choice but to pass them. And when, and this is how he explained it, when he was passing them in tongues, he would say, God, why don't you do something about this? And the Lord said, I can't. Because for 2 years, I told you to stop. It doesn't matter what it is, if it is dominating you and you can't stop it, then you ain't free. And if you ain't free, you're going to pay a heavy price. Don't surrender your freedom. God's ultimate objective, listen to this, God's ultimate objective, his end game, his highest intent is not to get you to heaven. His ultimate objective is to set you free so that you can be everything he dreamed you would be. I told you last week, the reason why God wants us free is because our freedom is tied to our potential. And next week, I'm going to go into the difference of the mindset between the slave and the free man. And when you understand the difference between the mindset of the free man and the mindset of a slave, you'll understand why, if we live enslaved, we'll never live up to our potential. The person, listen to this, the person who cannot see the ultimate becomes enslaved by the immediate. Because you're playing a short game instead of a long game. Now I want to read you the same verse we started with, but I want to read it to you out of the Passion Translation. Let me be clear, the Anointed One has set us free, not partially. Not partially. But completely and wonderfully free. We must always cherish this truth and stubbornly refuse to go back into the bondages of our past. Amen. Whom the Son sets free is free partially. Oh, wait. That's the other translation, ain't it? Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Completely and wonderfully free. Free from what? Free from everything. The wonder of grace is that you are completely free, but not free to do, free to be. To be what God has dreamed you would be. It was for freedom. Freedom is the objective. It's the end game. It's complete and it's wonderful and it's freedom. Listen to this, because I told you this is going to take weeks to uncover. But it's freedom from the law. It's freedom from the sin that made the law necessary. And it's freedom from the curse that came about because of sin. You're free from the curse. This is the reason why you ought to you ought not listen to a preacher who will tell you you're cursed if you don't do this or you do that. Can I give you, if you're watching me online, get up and walk out right when they say it. Because you ought never allow anyone to pronounce a curse over you. Because if you're in Christ, you are free and you are blessed. Don't let them tell you that your behavior brings about a curse. You can't curse. Balaam discovered this, and Balaam wasn't exactly a great man. Balaam discovered you can't curse the people God has blessed. Can't do it no matter how hard you try. You're not cursed. If you're in Christ, the confession of your life ought to be, I'm blessed. I'm blessed in the city. I'm blessed in the field. I'm blessed when I go out. I'm blessed when I come in. And everything I put my hands to is blessed. Hallelujah, Father. You're free from legalism. And you're free from condemnation. Now, in the Greek, that phrase, that Christ set us free, it was for freedom. That Christ set us free. This is important because remember I shared with you the story last week of the African gray? Raise your hand if you heard that. The bird. A lot of you didn't raise your hand. Where were you last week? You better have been out making some big bucks. I went to a friend's house years ago, and he had this beautiful African gray parrot sitting on a limb. No cage, no leashes. No, nothing. Doors open. This was Oklahoma in the summer. He had doors open, windows open. That bird was one flap away from freedom. And I sat there and I looked at it, and his name was Charles. I said, Charles, I said, are his wings clipped? And Charles said, no, he can fly. I said, but he ain't in a cage. And Charles said, he don't need a cage no more. And he explained to me that when the bird was a baby, he had both his wings clipped and he was in a cage. But there came a time when the bird didn't need to be in a cage because the cage was in the bird. And so Charles removed the cage and he let the wings grow back out, but the bird didn't know he could fly. So in essence, he had been set free, but he wasn't free. I said to you last week, and I'm going to say, the blood of Christ that sets you free, but it's the words of Christ that make you free. Woo! And see, if you're not hearing and doing his words, you're free spiritually, but you'll never be free experientially. You'll be one of those broke and disgusted Christians, complaining about everything, why nothing ever good happens to you. And instead of looking to take over, you're looking to get out. Oh, come on now. Yeah. Listen, how can we be world conquerors when our greatest ambition is to go to heaven? Death ought to find you doing. Death ought to be an inconvenient reality. It's like when it comes, you ought to say, not yet. I got one more thing I got to do. I got one more book I got to write, one more song I got to sing, one more company I got to launch. I got to do something so my children's children have an inheritance. Death, you're going to have to wait a little while longer. Because I don't see life, listen, and the way Christianity is preached to most of us is a get out of hell free card. Instead of a live life till the fullest invitation. And we need to understand that Christianity is about living life to the fullest. Years ago, I used to say it this way, but some people found it maybe a little bit edgy. What a shame that those of us he died to give life can't wait to die. Think about that. He died that we might have life. And not only just life, but abundant life. And yet our single greatest desire is to die. It ought to be to live. And to live a life of freedom. You know, freedom. I mean, what does freedom even mean? Dr. Miles Monroe says freedom is kind of like beauty and love. You know it when you experience it, but it's hard to define. But freedom is really that. Listen, for years, my wife and I flew. We've flown over the Atlantic Ocean. I don't even know how many times when we used to be missionaries. And we were free to fly, but we weren't free to sit where we wanted to sit. Y'all following me? Because if we were free to sit where we wanted to sit, I would have never sat by the toilets. You ain't never experienced a 12-hour flight till you've experienced it sitting by the toilet. And you hear noises that haunt you for years. Because those walls are thin. And you're thinking, good God, why can't I be in first class? Because you're not as free as you ought to be. Because, come on, I'm going to meddle here. See, some of us have been conditioned to believe that the low class is okay. Right? Come on now. Well, you know, we're, after all, we're only Christians.
No, sir.
No. You, listen, y'all following me? You can be as free as you want to be, but you got to want it. Because if you want to go through life condemned and confined, you can, and you'll still go to heaven. But Brother Hagin used to teach us we ought to have a little bit of heaven to go to heaven with.
Yes, sir.
Amen? Amen? And if I had been totally free back in my missionary days, I promise you, and I wouldn't have felt bad for doing it, I would have gone first class, front of the airplane, so the only thing I heard was the drinking of the fine wine. Not the flatulence. So where was I? That Christ set us free. This literally means, listen to this, to go. Go free. Once he has set you free, now you got to go be free. Because otherwise you're like the bird sitting on the branch. You're free. All that bird had to do, is this okay? Y'all are looking at me like, all he had to do is flap his wings. And he could have flown out the window and been free. He was free, but he didn't go. See, a lot of us, we stand right at the door of freedom. We've been set free by the blood of Christ, but we don't go. We're not living the dream. Psalm 129, talking about the Babylonian captivity. He said, when the Lord turned our captivity, when the Lord turned our captivity. In other words, when he set us free, the psalmist said, I was like those who dream. When he turned our captivity, I was like those who dream. My life became a dream. Yes. See, God has ordained for your life to be a dream, not a nightmare. The devil is the one that brings nightmares. God wants your life to be like a dream. When you wake up in the morning, you can't hardly believe how blessed you are. When you wake up in the morning, you can't hardly believe how free you are. Because you're pain-free. You're debt-free. You're emotionally free. You're stress-free. You're worry-free. He has set, because whom the Son has set free is free indeed. So don't let him tell you you ought to be a little bit fearful. No, you ought to be fear-free. I've heard that nonsense. Well, Pastor, you know, a little bit of fear is good for you. Well, let's follow that along. Fear will kill you, so arsenic. So maybe a little bit of arsenic is good for you. Shambaba. Listen to this. This go be free, we see this. Man, I got to hurry up. I got 8 pages and I'm only on halfway through the first. John chapter 8, verse 11. Put that up on the screen, please. That Christ set us free, it means to go. Be free. Be free. Be courageous enough to explore the land called freedom. And don't let them bewitch you. Don't let them tell you this or tell you that or tell you, you know, God wants you. Well, God don't want you to have everything because then he won't be able to control you. God don't want to control you. He wants to direct you. The steps of a righteous man, the steps of a righteous man, they're the steps of the righteous man, but they're ordered of the Lord. God just wants to direct you because when he directs you into a larger place. He directs you into a wealthy place. He directs you into a land of abundance. He doesn't want to put one foot in front of the other. He wants you to be courageous enough to take the step. And then he'll tell you, veer a little bit to the left, veer a little bit to the right, do this, do that. But you're the motion, the courage to step out, to flap the wings, to take a risk. That's got to be yours. If you want security, you'll end up with slavery. Faith requires risk. I discovered, man, when we lived on the mission field, I discovered faith is synonymous for risk. My wife shared with you how when we were in that building and we were in the same thing. They wanted us out. We wanted out because that building was filled with mold. But we couldn't find a place in Greenville to meet and have church. When you empty out your bank account, both the church's and your own, take it down to zero. That's a risk. Faith always requires risk. So in John chapter 8, verse 11, you know this story. A woman had been caught in the very act. Everyone say act. That means there were at least two. She was caught in the very act of adultery, and yet they brought only her. Now it's interesting, not everyone agrees, but I tend to agree with those who say that she was probably a temple prostitute. She served the priest. Which is why they knew when and where to find her, because they employed her. And so they caught her in the very act, and yet they only brought her, and they brought her conveniently to Jesus, because they had condemned her. Now listen to this. They used her, but they condemned her. And they brought her and they had her dead to rights, quite literally dead to rights, even though they conveniently left somebody else behind. And they asked Jesus about the law and should she not be stoned. And Jesus, of course, knew they had her, but love always triumphs and mercy always rejoices against judgment. And so the Lord asked a question. You who are without sin, and there are some who say that what he really said was this, those of you who are without this very sin. Because remember, if she was a temple prostitute, let's keep it real, ain't not one of those boys innocent. You who ain't been with her. Here's your stone. Have at it. You all right? And you know they all began to drop their stones because they all looked at each other and said, well, you were with her on Tuesday, yeah, but you were there Wednesday. And, well, I was there Wednesday afternoon. All right, I guess we'll just go home. And there she is. She's expecting to die any moment. And I love the imagery as the lifter of her head. I picture the Messiah tenderly bending down and grabbing her chin and lifting her up. And I believe that when she opened up her eyes, because you know your eyes would be clenched tight when you're expecting anything, that stone to hit you at any moment. When she opened up her eyes, in my mind's eye, I see her looking full in the Master's eyes. And he said, where are those who would condemn you? And they were nowhere to be found. And then he said this, he said, neither do I condemn you. The word condemn means to disapprove completely. Now I want you to understand the thing about the Lord. She had been caught in the act. She was guilty. But he said, I do not condemn you. The only one who could won't. And then he says this. Put that back up on the screen. Go from now on, sin no more. Look at the word after either. What is that? Go. From this place of newfound value, from this place of self-worth, from this place of no longer being condemned, from this place of freedom, go and be free from the sin that has defined you and brought you condemnation your whole adult life. From this place of being set free, now go and be free. That's a perfect imagery of what Paul was saying in Galatians. He has set you free, but are you? And if you're not, why not? It's either because we have accepted faulty teaching. Boy, I'm not following my notes at all. And we have been led to believe that a little bit of condemnation is good for us. A little bit of slavery keeps us humble. And we've never embraced this abundant life that God has for us, where he wants us to be completely free. Where the only voice is his voice. And the only one that establishes our value is him. For the Bible says that it's in him that we live. It's in him that we move. It's in him that we have our identification, or we know who we are. Because in him, I'm not defined by what you see. In him, I'm not defined by what I did. In him, I'm not defined by what my parents did, what my grandparents did, what my great-grandparents did. In him, I'm only defined by him. Is this okay this morning? Is it possible that this thing we call Christianity has always been much greater than what we've been led to believe? Is it possible that this thing we call Christianity has more to do with how we live than when we die? Is it possible that this thing called Christianity is more about living and dying? You understand what I mean by that? Just living to die. Is it possible that there's more to this life than that? That God has set before you freedom so that you can make a difference in your generation? Nobody remembers slaves. Slaves live and die and are forgotten. But it's free men and free women who use their freedom to benefit the generation that they live in. They are the ones who are remembered. So Jesus set you free. The question is from what? And the answer is from everything that diminishes you. Everything. Now, I want to, for the sake of time, I'm not going to get far in this. Let's talk about the process of freedom. Because your freedom isn't won with guns and swords and shields. It's won by faith. In the process of freedom, freedom like everything, listen to me, freedom like everything in the kingdom begins internally and works its way out externally. I want to say that again. Freedom begins internally. Most of us are looking outward for things to change. We need to be kingdom citizens. It ain't about what goes on out here. Because you know, in the kingdom, when you make that switch and you finally realize I'm a free man, they can't build a prison strong enough to keep you. Ain't nobody listening to me right now. Because we're looking to the Democrats to do their thing and set us free, or the Republicans to do their thing and set us free. We're putting our faith in politicians and we're waiting for them to do something. What we need to do is realize He's already set us free. Let's make the shift on the inside and declare ourselves to be free. And when we're free and He's for us and not against us, when we realize God is with me, then there is no law that can confine you. There is no executive order that can strip you of your prosperity. If whatever God has to do in order to do it, He'll do it. But you and I got to realize it ain't about what they do, it's about what He did. We got to put our faith in the right one. Everything begins internal. Listen to this. God changes you before you change your environment. I'm going to say that again. God changes you before you change your environment. Not the other way around. In Luke chapter 17, verse 21, reading it to you out of the Amplified, Jesus was trying to explain the kingdom. And He was telling the people, He said, listen, there's going to come a day when you're not going to be able to say, look, there's the kingdom. No, the kingdom's over here. No, the kingdom's in Rome, the kingdom's in Jerusalem, the kingdom's in Tulsa, the kingdom's in Pensacola, the kingdom is in Topeka. I just got to go to where the king is. He said there's going to come a day when you're not going to say it's over there or it's over there, because the kingdom of God is where? Put that back up. Put that verse back up. The kingdom of God is where? The kingdom of God is where? It's within you. And among you, surrounding you. But notice that before it states it's surrounding you, it's in you. Do you see this? So I'm going to tell you straight up, and I'm saying this as one who struggled for years. The struggle of our faith is that we don't believe the simplicity of the word. For years, I thought I was actually doing God an honor by being poor. That I was showing Him the length of my devotion. I didn't have to be like those money-grubbing preachers. And you know something I discovered about people with slave mentality? They always make excuses, yes, sir, instead of taking advantage of opportunities. Right. Amen or oh me. I did it for years, and she had to suffer. Because I just thought I'd been conditioned to be poor. But then when I made a shift, and that's all it was a shift, I realized that He had already set me free. Now the fight was on because I passed over 1,000 opportunities to remain poor. Wow. I remember one time after I had preached, we were missionaries in Poland. Is this okay this morning? Okay. I ain't never going to finish, so why try? It's not your fault. I was preaching for this guy as a missionary. I was in his church as a guest. And while I was in his church, proper protocol is he took care of my lodging and my meals. Right? But then when I was done preaching, he was driving me to my next meeting. And in our route to our meeting, because it was a several hour drive, we stopped to have a meal. And when we were eating and we were fellowshipping, when the ticket came, I was waiting for him to grab it. Because I was the missionary. And you know what the Lord, I'll never forget, the Lord said, if He pays this bill, you will forever be confined to a poverty mindset. Wow. I knew I was at that moment in time where I either had to step out and go be free or use my conditioning as an excuse, because after all, I'm just a poor missionary. I can't pay for a rich pastor's meal. And when the Lord said that, He said, you'll be forever. Now, I don't know if that meant I would have been forever, but it would have been a long time. But that's how I heard it. You understand that, right? That this was going to be, I was going to be You know how quickly I reached for that ticket? I would have knocked over an old woman if she'd gotten between me and that ticket. And when Pastor John went to reach for it, I said, don't you. I think a demon took over because I went, don't you take it. I was going to pay that. And then when I paid that, I felt a shift. Yeah. Just because I'm a missionary in Eastern Europe doesn't mean I got to be broke. Amen. That the same God who blesses people in America is the same God who lives in Poland, yeah. Same God who lives in Africa, same God who lives in India. And God's desire is not just for Americans to be free. He wants Africans to be free. He wants Indians to be free. He wants Pakistanis to be free. He wants every man, every woman of every tribe and every tongue and every color to be free because he created men for freedom. But it always begins, good night, that clock's got to be going fast. It always begins on the inside. If you can recall the day you gave your life to Christ and instantly became a new creature, you walked down a sinner and you walked back a saint. But listen. If you went down there with long auburn hair, you didn't walk back with short gold-colored hair. Right? If you walked down skinny, you came back skinny. If you walked down there fat, you came back fat. What am I saying? When you received Christ, it changed, but not on the outside. It changed on the inside. And then because there was a change on the inside, step by step, the process began to manifest on the outside. Maybe the Saturday night before you went down and got saved, your house, which was party headquarters, was a madhouse. And you left beer bottles and all kinds of other paraphernalia strewn all over the place. You went to church, you got saved, you left party HQ. But over the process of time, you began to make changes. Pretty soon you were telling your friends, no, we don't do that here no more. And you cleaned it up and you cleaned it out. And what was party HQ now became Holy Ghost HQ. And you were getting drunk, but you were doing it on a brand new wine. Y'all understand what I'm saying? But it wasn't instantaneous. If you left the house filthy, you went back to it filthy. Hey, Bill, I need more time, bro. Just one look at you. Hallelujah. Where was I? Listen, freedom begins within. I'm only on page 2 of 8. We ain't going to get too far. Freedom begins within. Freedom internally, spiritually, is instantaneous and complete. But freedom externally is a process and step by step. First, you'll be free of sin. You'll find that the things that used to control you, you don't need to do anymore. And so step by step, you begin to divorce yourself of all those things that used to dominate you. And then pretty soon you discover you're free from the law itself. It ain't about the hairstyle and the clothing style and the lack of style. You're free to be you. One of the greatest freedoms is the realization I don't got to copy all those uptight people. You know the ones that'll tell you, if you just listen to what I say, you'll dress right, walk right, talk right, and you'll have eternal salvation. And then what I discovered is they're too uptight to be right. And so you get freedom from them and even freedom from yourself. You're free to be you, the you that God created you to be. And then he sets you free from condemnation. John chapter 8, I'll bring it to a close with this. Is this okay this morning? John chapter 8, verse 31 and 32, reading it to you out of the Amplified. So Jesus said to those Jews who had believed in him, now notice, they had believed in him. I want to say it again, they believed in him, but they were still trapped by Judaism. They believed in him, but they were still trapped by religion. He said, if you abide in my word, hold fast to my teachings and live in accordance with them, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. I want to say this because last week I started off by saying the ultimate objective of faith is to make God's truth my reality. Y'all get that? The ultimate objective of faith working in my life is to take all of God's truth and make it my daily reality. Because it's by faith that I make an avenue for grace to flood my life. Never accept those who say there's a battle somewhere between the faith message and the grace message. Because I like what I heard Andrew Womack say one time. He said, faith cannot obtain anything for you that grace has not provided. But if grace has provided it, the way you obtain it is faith. So your faith can't just get anything, it gets everything that grace has provided. So the ultimate objective of my faith is to take the totality of God's truth and make it my daily reality. And then Jesus said the objective of truth is freedom. You shall know the truth and the truth shall set you free. So you could say it this way, the ultimate objective of my faith is freedom. That the more I walk by faith, the freer I get. So I employ faith in the area of my finances. Right? Because I know that there is a place called financial freedom. When I've been dominated by toxic relationships and I'm emotionally damaged, I begin to walk by faith. And I know that by faith, there's a place of emotional freedom, relational freedom. And then if I'm one of those people that have worried about everything all my life, I worry. There ain't nothing good. If I see a tree in bloom, I say, well, it's only going to die shortly anyhow. Everything is worry. There's a place where I'm stress-free and worry-free. Because by faith, I've learned that one of God's truth is that I can cast all of my anxieties over on Him because He lovingly cares for me. It was for freedom that Christ set us free. I'm telling you what, the next six pages of notes are good, but we ain't got time. Is it possible to be free spiritually and live a life of bondage? Yes, and most Christians do. But I wrote this down, but as for me and RLC, we will be free. Free from condemnation, and I'll end with this. This is where we'll end, Romans chapter 8, and I'll pick up with it next week. Therefore, there is now. Now means at the present time. I'm not waiting for freedom at a future date. There is no condemnation. Remember, what did we say? What was condemnation? It's a sense of disapproval. Where they disapprove of you. And truth be told, most of us disapprove of ourselves. Condemnation is it's like it's all-inclusive. You hate the image you see in the mirror because you don't measure up to them. You measure yourself by your own failures. And you know, can I be honest? Nobody knows how great your failures as much as you do. And so you look at the image you see in the mirror and you think, I'll never measure up. I don't deserve to be blessed. I don't deserve to be free. Poverty and pain is all I really deserve. And you know what? That's true. You don't deserve it. You don't deserve freedom. But grace, amazing grace. I don't deserve to be free, but He made me free. I don't deserve to be happy, but He filled me with joy. I don't deserve an abundant life, but it's what He gave me. So it's not about my past. It's not about the things I've done. There is now no condemnation. I don't clothe myself with it, and I ain't going to let you clothe it on me. I correct people. I don't know about you, but there's this one person I have to deal with from time to time, and he just likes saying, oh, you poor man. I think he says it to everyone, but personally, I don't like it. Poor, who are you talking to, Jack? I ain't poor. I'm blessed. I'm blessed in the city. Look around. I'm in the city, so I'm blessed. If I take a drive up to the mountains, I look around. I'm in the country. So you know what I do? I'm blessed. Whatever I put my hands to, you know what I feel? I feel blessed. Listen, it's okay. Can I end with this? I may not, but I'm going to ask you if I can. You have divine permission to be blessed. You have divine permission to be happy. You have divine permission to live a good and godly life. He has ordained it for you. As we close, here's my question. Are you courageous enough? Are you willing to leave the perch? Are you willing? Are you willing to stretch out? Well, Pastor, I don't know what they'll think if I stretch my wings. Because, you know, you might be with a flock of paralyzed birds. And, Pastor, what are they going to think if I stretch my wings? I don't know. Why don't you try and see? Maybe, just maybe, you might inspire one or two. And the naysayers and the ones who say, well, you know, I don't know about that spreading of the wings stuff. Just leave them behind. But I'm bringing it to a close. Why don't you stretch your wings and then just say, well, you know, what if? What if I attempt something great for God and it works? What if I flap my wings and discover that I won't fall? What if it actually is true when he said, I'll mount up with wings like an eagle? What if God wasn't joking when he made all of these wonderful promises? What if? Stand to your feet. Hallelujah, Father. Thank you, Father. If we can get our prayer team to come up, if you need prayer this morning, if you're here and you've never received Jesus as your Christ, as your Savior, as your Redeemer, I beg you, you don't need to live another day without Him. Because the Bible says that today is the day of salvation. If you're here this morning and you're in pain, if you're here this morning and you're just like, you know what, this freedom thing seems like a dream, but not always a good one. We want to pray with you and for you and to build up your faith with faith-filled words. Hallelujah. I also want to remind you, if you want, we bought a whole bunch of cupcakes. You all need to eat them. I'd love to meet you in the cafe. Maybe y'all can sing me happy birthday or something again. That's all right. You got to love me. Father, we thank you for your word. I thank you, Father, that no matter what our age, whether we're young or we're old, freedom is your ultimate objective. And so, Father, we make our voice harmonize with yours, and we say that we want to be free. Yes. We desire, Father, freedom, not partial, but complete and wonderful freedom. And, Father, our commitment to you is we will steadfastly refuse to be put back under a yoke of bondage. Your word is working mightily in our lives. So in Jesus' name, our declaration is, say this with me, I am free. Give God praise. Amen. All right, and if you need prayer, come forward. If you don't need prayer, go and eat some calories.